Lovely to be able to share with you today, whether you're here in the building or joining us online, whether you're here on a Sunday morning or whether you've stumbled across the recording at some time in the future. God is with us. God is with you. And we're delighted to be able to share worship together. And before we continue with our worship, we share the news that our dear friend Jean Pierce died this Thursday. Jean was 93 years old and was brought here as a baby by her mother. So 93 years of sharing in the life of this fellowship here. She now shares with us in a very different way as part of the communion of saints in heaven. There are currently no details of her services, but we will make sure that you know those as soon as we have them ourselves. But we want to mark Jean's faith and life as part of this church family before we begin our worship. So please stand. And we'll keep a moment of quietness, thanking God for Jean, and then I will lead us in a prayer. Loving God, we praise you for the communion of saints, which joins your people in every age and every place, joining us even across the river of death itself. As we stand together this morning, we remember Jean, the many, many years that she has been part of this church family. We thank you for the contribution that she has made, the ways in which her life has enriched our lives, and for her faith in Jesus, through whom death is conquered and heaven is opened. We pray for her family and those who will miss her most, and we thank you for the assurance of resurrection life and the eternal life with you in heaven, which is now Jean's to enjoy. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Friends, I invite you to remain standing. We're going to share together as a call to worship a version of Psalm 30. I will lead the words in the light type, and then I invite us all to join together in the blue type. I will exalt you, O Lord, because you have raised me up and have not let my foes triumph over me. O Lord, my God, I cried out to you, and you have healed me. You brought me up, O Lord, from the dead. You restored me to life from among those that go down to the pit. Sing to the Lord, you servants of his. Give thanks to his holy name, for his wrath endures but the twinkling of an eye, and his favour for a lifetime. Heaviness may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. You've turned my mourning into dancing. You've put off my sackcloth and girded me with gladness. Therefore my heart sings to you without ceasing. O Lord, my God, I will give you thanks forever. Our opening hymn, the words on the screen, or number 79 in the hymn book, I'll praise my Maker while I've breath.
Thank you.
Please be seated. And we pray together. Loving God, we gather together to bring our praise and our worship. Whether we are here on site, whether we're joining online, we are all in person, united by your Holy Spirit, one in Jesus Christ, and one in heart and mind as we bring our praise and our thanksgiving. Lord, we long that what we have sung will be true, that our very latest breath will be a breath of praise for your goodness and your magnificence and your kindness and your forgiveness and the hope that we have in you. Lord, we praise you for the world that you have made. We praise you for the bits that we understand and the bits that still confound us, for the bits that we've discovered and the bits that still lie hidden from us, from the parts of creation that lift our hearts and expand our minds by their magnificence, and those parts of creation that amaze us by their minusculeness. Lord God, you are an extraordinary God, a creating God, a God of variety and of diversity, and yet you love us, every single one of us. You love us as your children. You love us as a parent loves their child and longs the best for them. You love us as the one in whom you bring potential to flourish. You love us as the one who looks on us and loves us despite our failings and our faults. And that just amazes us. And because we know that you love us, we can come to you just as we are. We can come to you with honesty and integrity, confessing the weakness of our faith, confessing a discipleship that is so often faltering, confessing character traits which betray the name of Jesus on our lips. And you've made us a wonderful promise that when we confess those things, you are faithful and righteous and will forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so we pray, loving God, that even as we worship together now, your Holy Spirit would work within our lives, renewing the likeness of Jesus within us, that we might be more like Jesus and so reflect your heart for humanity and for creation. Lord, restore our relationship with creation. Make us good stewards of all that you have made, that others might experience your kindness and your justice and their fullness. Renew in us the character and the kindness of Jesus, that our relationship with one another might be renewed and restored and redeemed. And by your Spirit, Lord, draw us evermore into your heart, that we might know your ways, that we might know your purposes, that we might know your love, as individuals, as a church, and for the whole world. Lord, renew us in the likeness of Christ, and may that be another cause for our praise. For we ask this in the name of Jesus, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Friends, we come to that point on my order of service where it still says a flexible 5 minutes, which is my get-out clause if I don't really know what's happening. happening in the next few minutes, and it gives me the opportunity to remember everything I've forgotten. But you know, those of you who've been around long enough know that what we always do in our flexible 5 minutes is to make sure that everybody feels at home and welcome. So please just spend a few minutes talking to one another, making sure that no one feels strange here. I once said we don't want strangers here. You know what I mean. We do want strangers. We just don't want anyone to feel like a stranger. So make sure you talk to people. Start the conversation with your name, even if you're married to the person, because that saves that embarrassment. And I'll interrupt ere long. Carry on. Okay, folk, I hope you've had a chance to start a conversation. You won't have time to finish it, but there is tea and coffee afterwards. Or if you find you've got something that needs carrying on now, just go out and carry on. That's absolutely fine. Just to say that we are going to share Holy Communion together this morning. No one, of course, has to join in, but if you're very welcome to. If you want to come to the rail, then what we're going to suggest that we do is that we move, and we're going to start with this side. All right, we're going to come out this way, come to the rail and then back through the middle. And then if you're on this side, come out the window side and back up the middle. As always, just interrupt them in the gallery. Just sort of come and join us at whatever time you want. There will be the opportunity to kneel at the rail, much as we have done previously. When Janet brings the wine to you, she will offer you the tray. And if you could take your own glass, then that would be absolutely fine. However, we are still in very strange times. Some of us here have been at Methodist Conference this week, and we've watched people drop away with COVID during the week. So if you would rather stay where you are in your seat, that is absolutely fine. If you want to stay where you are with your seat and share in communion using one of these pre-packed things that we've been using for the last, goodness knows how long. They are at the back there, and during a hymn you could go and get those. They have the wafer and the wine all in one piece if you don't want to come to the front. If you want to come to the front but you don't want to receive the bread and the wine from the trays, then you can bring these with you if that's what you'd like to do. So however you want to share in that part of the worship, you are invited to do it, all right? There are no rules. However you feel comfortable in sharing in communion, if that is actually not sharing in bread and wine at all, that is also absolutely fine. I simply invite you to share in that part of the service in the way that is most comfortable for you. And when it comes to the liturgy, the words will appear on the screen. I apologize in advance for the lurid red writing. It's on my computer, it's that beautiful deep Methodist red that we use, but not when you put it up here, so it shouts at you. So I apologize, and I will change it for next time. And while I'm on the matter of apologies, Linda's going to come and read our scripture in a few minutes' time. Now, if you're on our scripture reading rota, you have reason to be thankful this morning that it isn't you. It is Linda, and so I apologize in advance for giving you such a nightmare reading. And when you finish this, I will have to remember how you've pronounced Mephibosheth, so I get it right all the way through. We decided before we were going to do it confidently and consistently and believe that therefore you will think, oh, that's how it's announced, right? So we hear our Old Testament scripture from 2 Samuel and chapter 9.
And beginning at verse 1, the story of David and Mephibosheth. David asked, "Is there anyone still left in the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake?" Now there was a servant of Saul's household named Ziba. They summoned him to appear before David. And the king said to him, "Are you Ziba?" "At your service," he replied. The king asked, "Is there still no one alive from the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness?" Ziba answered the king, "There is still a son of Jonathan. He is lame in both feet." "Where is he?" the king asked. Ziba answered, "He is at the house of Machir, son of Amiel in Lo Debar." So King David brought him from Lo Debar, from the house of Machir, the son of Amiel. When Mephibosheth, son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, came to David, he bowed down to pay him honour. David said, "Mephibosheth." "At your service," he replied. "Don't be afraid," David said to him, "for I will surely show you kindness for the sake of your father Jonathan. I will restore to you all the land that belonged to your grandfather Saul, and you will always eat at my table." Mephibosheth bowed down and said, "What is your servant that you should notice a dead dog like me?" Then the king summoned Ziba, Saul's steward, and said to him, "I have given your master's grandson everything that belonged to Saul and his family. You and your sons and your servants are to farm the land for him and bring in the crops, so that your master's grandson may be provided for. And Mephibosheth, grandson of your master, will always eat at my table." Now Ziba had 15 sons and 20 servants. Then Ziba said to the king, "Your servant will do whatever my lord the king commands his servants to do." So Mephibosheth ate at David's table like one of the king's sons. Thanks be to God for his word to us.
Thank you. Our hymn 416, 416. There's a wideness in God's mercy like the wideness of the sea.
Thank you.
And then we turn to Luke's Gospel and chapter 14, reading from verse 15. The parable of the great banquet. When one of those at the table with him heard this, he said to Jesus, "Blessed is the one who will eat the feast in the kingdom." Jesus replied, "A certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. At the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who had been invited, 'Come, for everything is now ready.' But they all alike began to make excuses. The first said, 'I've just bought a field and I must go and see it. Please excuse me.' Another said, 'I have just bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm on my way to try them out. Please excuse me.' Still another said, 'I just got married, so I can't come.' The servant came back and reported this to his master. Then the owner of the house became angry and ordered his servant, 'Go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame.' 'Sir,' the servant said, 'what you ordered has been done, but there is still room.' Then the master told his servant, 'Go out to the roads and country lanes and compel them to come in, so that my house will be full. I tell you, not one of those who were invited will get a taste of my banquet.'" Amen.
Let's pray. There's a wideness in God's mercy like the wideness of the sea. There's a kindness in his justice which is more than liberty. Lord God, we have already brought our prayers of praise, standing back in wonder at the magnificence of your creation. But in these moments, we recognize that that beauty is broken. That there is pain and sadness and fear and hostility. So we come to pray for your world and for our part within it. Lord, we pray for climate justice for all. Whilst we experience extremes of weather here in this country, we so easily forget that in other parts of the world, the impacts of climate change threaten life itself, threaten communities laying on low-lying islands, threatening generations of livelihood and existence. So we pray for those around the world with the power and the influence to make the big decisions that will reverse climate change. We pray for our own contributions that we can make as individual people, as communities. And as the Methodist Connection committed itself again this week to be carbon neutral by 2030, we recognize our part within the whole of the Methodist Church. And that as we talk about the struggle for justice and our determination to create, to be a justice-seeking church in so many other ways, Lord, we ask that we will not forget the commitment to be a justice-seeking church in terms of climate justice. Lord, we pray that we would recommit ourselves also to be a justice-seeking church, looking for peace and kindness around the world, working in our own communities, our own nation, but across the world also, Lord, that peace, a just peace, might come. And so we pause and remember again the conflict in Ukraine, praying for those who seek for peace, and praying for those intent on war. Praying for those who are forced to fight. Praying for those who have lost loved ones. Praying for those who live with the uncertainty of not knowing what has happened to friends and family. And we thank you, Lord, for the community of guests from Ukraine that are here in Cornwall, and particularly we remember those who gather here week by week at the drop-in. We thank you for those who work hard to make that drop-in a welcoming and supportive time. And Lord, we thank you that what happens in and from this place shows the partnership that is being shared across the country and across the world, where those driven out from their homes by injustice and by warfare can find a welcome and can find community. Lord, as we seek to be a justice-seeking church, we pray for those who face the most uncertainty in the economic climate, as prices rise, as difficult decisions are made by governments and by families, by groups and by individuals, as the availability of food is impacted by the war. Lord, we pray for those most vulnerable around the world and in our own nation. We pray for those in our own church family who are facing uncertainty and difficult economic decisions. We pray for economic systems that serve the majority, not the few. And so we pray for each other. Those we have carried on our hearts to worship. The concerns that we have. The fears that we carry. The anxieties that we bear. Lord, make us whole. Even as we worship, even as we pray for others, Lord, we know that you invite us to love ourselves as we love our neighbour, as we love you. And so, Lord, we pray for your world, for those we love, and for ourselves, a wholeness and a healing. In the name of Christ. Amen. Our loving God, as we open your written word, we pray that by your Holy Spirit, it would be for us your living word. In Jesus' name. Amen. Before we think about that Old Testament passage together, I'm actually going to remove the cloth from the communion table. By the time this short address finishes, we will be at communion, and I want just to be able to have that as a visual aid as we move through our sermon. I want us just for a few moments this morning to explore the story of Mephibosheth. That's struggle number one. It's a story which I guess I've read so many times over the years, like so many of us. I have a way of reading the Bible each year, so I hear this story. But sometimes things come to you in a particular way, with particular power. That is the power, of course, of the living Word of God. And I want us to explore this story under the title, Grace at the Table. And if you want a text, then it would be this from chapter 9 and verse 11. So Mephibosheth ate at David's table like one of the king's sons. At the beginning of that reading, David asks, "Is there anyone still left of the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake?" Now you'll remember the story, perhaps, that Jonathan was David's soulmate, his friend, and yet Saul and Jonathan were both killed, probably about 16 years ago at this point in the story, in the battlefield, and that David became king. David became king. And he's looking back and he's saying, is there anyone still left of the house of Saul, that's Jonathan's father, to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake? And they come up with this chap called Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth was summoned to be in the king's presence. Now, in order to understand the power of this story, we need to understand the traditions of the time in which David lived. When a king came to power, it was difficult to trust that those who supported the previous king or monarch would not decide to try and depose you. There weren't the sort of organized treaties that or indeed succession planning that we might anticipate in our world today. And so one of the things that was traditional in the day is that when a king came to power, he had executed every member of the previous monarch's family. They were less likely to challenge for the throne if they were dead, the theory goes. And so the tradition was that everybody would be executed. So when David asks, is there someone to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake? And Ziba says, yes, there's Mephibosheth. Everyone had reason to think that what was really going on was that David was just clearing up the loose ends, making sure that no one that was a child when Jonathan and Saul died and was now an adult was able to pose a threat to David's rule as king. That was the tradition. And so when Mephibosheth is brought into the king's company, he shouldn't have been there in that context. His past should have debarred him. The person he was should have meant that actually the last place he wanted to be was in the king's presence, because that only ended one way. But there is something else about the traditions of the day which are really important to us understanding the power of this story, the gospel power of this story. Several times in the story of Mephibosheth, actually it says that Mephibosheth was lame in both feet. Now the story is, if you go back to 2 Samuel chapter 4, we read this: Jonathan, son of Saul, had a son who was lame in both feet. He was 5 years old when the news about Saul and Jonathan came from Jezreel that they had been killed. His nurse picked him up and fled. Why did his nurse pick him up as fled? Because he would be next. That was the tradition. You killed all the family. Then it goes on, but as she hurried to leave, she fell and he became disabled. His name was Mephibosheth. So this man was crippled in both legs because he was dropped by his nurse when they were fleeing the authorities of David. Trying to escape being executed according to tradition, this man was now crippled. And the other thing that was never present in the company of the king was somebody who was disabled. There's still a stigma around many forms of disability today. We're a justice-seeking church. We're challenging that. Tame this back all these years, and that would be another reason to have them put down, literally. Certainly not to have them in the presence of the king. The king was to be surrounded by all that was magnificent, all that was wonderful, all that was great, all that pointed towards the king's own magnificence. And people who the world thought were not magnificent were not part of the picture. So the tradition said that Mephibosheth should not have been in the company of the king. The tradition said his past, the person he was, should have made him unwelcome. He shouldn't have been eating with the king. His condition, his present condition said, you know what? You should not be in the presence of the king. And so we're watching here a moment of grace where the expectations are turned on their head. Where the grace of David's welcome flies in the face of tradition and common sense. So the tradition. What about the expectation? Well, Mephibosheth himself had no reason to think that he would be welcomed in the king's court. Verse 8 there, Mephibosheth bowed down and said, "What is your servant that you should notice a dead dog like me?" What is it that you should notice a dead dog like me? Not only was Mephibosheth not regarded as worthy by everybody else, he didn't regard himself as worthy either. The impact of a society that had been sat upon him, that had put him down, that had written him off, that had said he was nothing, that said he had no right to live, well, that had had its impact. And as is so often the case, Mephibosheth had believed the lie that others said about him, that he wasn't worthy, that he wasn't worth living, that he was like a dead dog, worth nothing. And so as Mephibosheth came into the king's presence, not only was the tradition against him, his own expectations were against him. And yet he was welcomed. "Don't be afraid," says David. "Don't be afraid, for I will surely show you kindness for the sake of your servant, your father, Jonathan." Don't be afraid. I don't mind what tradition says. I don't mind what other people say. I don't mind what you think about yourself. You are welcome here at my table. You at the end of the sermon yet? You are welcome here at my table. I will show you kindness. In 9:22, I preached from Hosea, and I said that one of the wonderful words in Hosea was the word Heseth, which is covenant love. I had no idea until yesterday when I clicked on the word kindness that that's the same word. I, says David, will show you Heseth. I will show you covenant love. I will show you, who everybody else is writing off, the love with which God holds us all. The love that will not let me go. The love that will not turn away. The love that will not reject. The love that will not stop trying harder. I will welcome you with that kind of love, despite the fact that your past should debar you. Despite the fact that your present condition makes you unworthy, despite the fact that the world has written you off, despite the fact that you've written yourself off, I'm going to love you. I'm going to show you kindness. The tradition, the expectation, the welcome, the blessing. David says, verse 7, "I will restore to you all the land that belonged to your grandfather Saul, and you'll always eat at my table." There is an abundant blessing. What you have lost, what you thought was taken away, I'm going to give it back to you. I'm going to give you all that you need, and I'm going to bless your socks off. That's a message version. The blessing that Mephibosheth discovers when he comes into the presence of the king. He is not worthy, he did not expect, he does not deserve, and yet, as he's carried to the table because he's lame in both feet, he is blessed abundantly by the kindness of the king. Now, I need to say, the story gets complicated. If you read on, the story gets complicated. Ziba turns out to be a bit of a rogue. So it's not a straightforward story, but the power of this simple story spoke to me, knowing that we're coming here. The tradition, you're not welcome. You shouldn't be here. You should be dead. The expectation, your life really isn't worth it. You're not worthy. The welcome, but I'll show you kindness. And the blessing. But we have to spend a little time thinking about the reason. Why did David behave like this when all expectations were to the contrary? And for that, we come back to that very first verse again. Again, it's the word Hesed. Is there anyone still left of the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness, mercy, covenant love for Jonathan's sake? You know, there was a time in conference in the ordination services last week where those that are to be ordained, those that are in the congregation shout out, they are worthy. They are worthy. It's one of those powerful moments. If you do ever get the chance to be at an ordination service, and I know that some of you were here when we hosted one here, it is a spine-tingling moment. Are those ordinands arrogant enough to think they are worthy of the love of God? Are they foolish enough to think that they are deemed to be without fault? Of course they're not. But God declares them to be worthy, just as David declared Mephibosheth to be worthy. It's all about Hesed. It's all about kindness. It's all about the love with which, in which God holds us in spite of who we are, not because of who we are. Then Ziba said to the king, "Your servant will do whatever my lord the king commands his servant to do." So Mephibosheth ate at David's table like one of the king's son. He ate at the table of the king. The table is set before us. The invitation is extended. The grace is shared. The welcome is genuine, and the blessing awaits us. Friends, in our turn, we are invited to the table of the king, not because we're worthy, but because we are loved. We're invited to the table of the king, not because we deserve to come, but because we're invited to come. We are invited to the table of the king, not because we are good enough, or clever enough, or rich enough, or influential enough, but because God wants to show us his kindness. In a few moments, we're going to say these words together, which came back to my mind as I read that story of Mephibosheth being carried to the table. As we do share these words, I'll read them in a minute, we're reminded again that the king still invites us to the table because of his grace, his love, his Hesed kindness. And we will know that his invitation is for all, and his blessing is for all, and his love is for all. This is what we'll say. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy even to gather up the crumbs under your table, but it is your nature always to have mercy, and on that we depend. So feed us with the body and blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that we may forever live in him and he in us. The tradition, the expectation, dead a threat, unworthy. Yet we find the welcome and the blessing and the reason is kindness. God's unshakable, undilutable, indestructible kindness to all. So Mephibosheth ate at David's table like one of the king's sons. And the king invites us to the table too. Amen. Our hymn 595, 595, Lord, we have come at your own invitation. Be seated. Friends, as I say, just share in this part of the service however you're comfortable, rather than make yourself uncomfortable. You come to the table, whether you literally come or whether you come in a different way. And so we share together in our liturgy. Lord and giver of every good thing, we bring to you bread and wine for our communion, lives and gifts for your kingdom, and all for transformation through grace and love, made known in Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We praise you, gracious Father, our Maker and Sustainer. You created the heavens and the earth and formed us in your own image. And though we sinned against you, your love for us was constant. And you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to be the Saviour of the world. Sharing our human nature, he was born of Mary and baptized in the Jordan. He proclaimed your kingdom by word and deed, and was put to death upon the cross.
You raised him from the dead. You exalted him in glory, and through him you have sent your Holy Spirit, calling us to be your people, a community of faith. And so with angels and archangels and all the choirs of heaven, we join in the triumphant hymn, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy God, we praise you that on the night in which he was betrayed, our Saviour Christ took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And after supper he took the cup of wine. He gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. Remembering therefore his death and resurrection, and proclaiming his eternal sacrifice, we offer ourselves to you in praise and thanksgiving as we declare the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Send down your Holy Spirit that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us the body and blood of Christ. Unite us with him forever and bring us with the whole creation to your eternal kingdom. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, we worship you in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread. And so we say together, Lord, we come to your table, trusting in your mercy and not in any goodness of our own. We are not worthy even to gather up the crumbs under your table, but it is your nature always to have mercy, and on that we depend. So feed us with the body and blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that we may forever live in him and he in us. Amen. The choir sing our anthem, Just As I Am. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Those who come to me shall not hunger, and those who believe in me shall never thirst. So come now with faith.
Friends, we have ate at the table of the King, not because we deserve it, but because God loves us. So let us pray. We thank you, Lord, that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet prepared for all people. Amen. And so our closing hymn is a mission hymn. As we have recognized the love that God has for us, we recognize also the love in which God holds the whole world, and we commit ourselves to share the kindness of God across the globe. Lord, your church on earth is seeking thy renewal from above. So as we have come to eat at the King's table, now we go to partner with the King to build the King's kingdom. The peace and the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen.